Hello everybody, welcome to the paper 2 last minute advice for geography Edexcel. I've left this very last minute again, same as last week or last paper, but yeah, let's sprint through it. So key points: paper 2 had a lot more specialist terminology, so make sure you get those key terms on lock, and always define these key terms first as they can easily give you one mark. And if you forget a case study, think simply and try to find case studies today. For example, you can mention things about conflict today very easily if you're struggling on health and human rights, for example. But yeah, let's move on. And you know the drill, so I've banged on about this every single time I've gone through exam questions or anything like that. Please use the spatial and temporal scale arguments, and they just need to carry through this paper as well. So how significant is your factor over the long or short term? How significant is your factor on a local, national, international scale? Blah, 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 it's getting boring now. So this is the argument you need to use, and especially for human topics, you can easily compare the long and short-term benefits of a factor. And a good example of this would be development aid in health and human rights. So you can always argue that in the short term, these are good, as there can be increased investments for poverty, stuff like that, poverty reduction schemes. But in the long term, it's very bad as it creates dependence on the funding. So yeah, let's move on. Alright, so globalization tips, sorry. So the key definition of globalization is the process of global integration of economies, politics, products, ideas, and other aspects of a culture. And by far, this is the easiest topic. So think simply, you can talk easily about the social, economic, environmental factors in this section. So I should be like Jaden Smith, talk about the political, economic state of the world, and you should be good. And you can pull case studies from Finnair in this section if you're missing a case study, or you can watch my video on it. I don't know, guys. Maybe you can speed on watching my video, increase the views on me. I'll be very happy if you did that. But an easy argument you can make for this section is to talk about the benefits of globalization in the developing versus developed world, and then you can compare how each country has developed. And good models you can use for this to flex on the exam for this section. So, number one, if the 12 marker is alluding to inequalities, you can flex your knowledge on with using the Gini coefficient, and you can say stuff like, referring to the Gini coefficient of each country, we can deduce that country X will have a higher Gini coefficient, 0.5 to 1, due to a high wealth divide. Guys, listen, it's just this one line. It's very good. You don't actually need to state an actual number, but by doing this, you add extra curry spice to your essays and make it stand out slightly compared to the thousands of other applicants. And you can also refer to Rostow's model to compare how different nations have developed and or how developed they are in general. So an example of this would be using Rostow's model, we can see that China was able to expand its economy rapidly in its takeoff phase through manufacturing industries. And as I said before, examiners will reach a state of euphoria reading something like this, as it shows you actually critically think and not just regurgitate vomit out some case studies that you studied 100 times. So yeah, this is a good thing to use, and let's move on to regeneration. So again, please define regeneration for the big questions. It is the long-term upgrading of existing places or more drastic renewal schemes. And if you haven't already, please play the devil's advocate. So how does the regeneration project affect both sides of a scheme? And a classic example of this would be the London Docklands. So if you watch my videos, I talk about how it's good. The Docklands regeneration was good for the national government in the long term with economic growth, but very bad for the local East End community who are forced out in the long term. And again, guys, I can't stress how important it is. This carries through to every topic you study. Please use the long term, short term, local, national, international scale argument. This is the paper where you should do it, because it's so easy to do and so easy to assess if you do this. And a very good model you can use for regeneration is the Kuznets curve. I talked about a Kuznets curve in the physical paper, and I think this fits in better with this topic. So my favorite argument back in my prime, that was like last year in my geography prime, was that I always said this one thing: by looking at the Kuznets curve, we can see how an increased income due to regeneration will directly lead to an increased care for an environment, due to more income for environmental projects. Therefore, in the long term, this regeneration project will not only improve local economies, but local natural and built environments. So guys, link it. Talk about economic glaze, I don't know. Just keep on talking about the Kuznets curve if you want. And yeah, it's a very easy way to tick off the economic and environmental benefits for a regeneration scheme. All right, so now we move on to superpowers. All right, moving on to superpower tips now. So like globalization, this is a very short section, so don't stress too much on it, but definitely try to do your best on it. So the key definition for a superpower would be a nation with the ability to project its influence anywhere in the world and act as a global dominant force. And again, for this part, just please just use the spatial and temporal argument. And especially for like stuff like tensions, you need to talk about the scale of conflicts, especially for like physical resources. You can talk about how like different conflicts, perhaps, for example, the China-Taiwan conflict is actually more international than a conflict that is within the Alberta Sands between the local people and the national government in Canada. So yeah, you can even compare the scale of conflicts together, and you can rope in different countries and talk about the interpolitical play they each have. So yeah, definitely talk about spatial temporal again. I've said this a million times. And unfortunately, I haven't done a video on it, but at this point, it's up to you. So if you have a case studies, annotate the spec, try find a little thing on the spec if you can. And yeah, just make sure you have a few big case studies for it that you can mold into different essays. And here's some models you can, like, again, flex on an examiner with. So again, you can use Rostow's modernization and Wallerstein's world systems theory. So Rostow's modernization, it can be used to compare the relative economic status of superpowers. So example I used quite a bit back in the day is using Rostow's model. It is clear that USA is a larger superpower than China, as USA is in its phase of high mass consumption, whereas China is in between its takeoff and drive to maturity phase. So like, you can compare superpowers using models, and this is a very good way of doing it, as opposed to using hard PSD. And another good one would be Wallerstein's world systems theory. This is part of the spec, and you can help identify the different levels to a superpower or just describe relationships. So another thing I used to say was using Wallerstein's theory, you can see how China and African regions, I should say, have developed neo-colonialist relations, with African regions being in the periphery and China in the semi-periphery. And this refers to China using trade with Africa to increase its economic importance. So simple stuff like this can get you extra marks. And again, think about it. If an examiner is reading thousands of essays or hundreds of essays, you got to make it stand out somewhere. And I think this is the way you should do it. All right, so now we move on to health and human rights. Again, I haven't made a video on this. Unfortunately, you guys are going to have to, I guess, deal with it, because I just can't physically make a video every single day. So those speedrun videos take me like at least a week to make, or even half a week to make. And I guess an easy argument to make is that aid in the short term is effective, but in the long term it's bad, because a dependence is created. So if this is a general point, if aid does come up, you can always mention this. And similar to the point above, if you asked about intervention or military interventions, you can mention how in the short term it's very effective in reducing immediate loss of life, but in the long term it's not so good, as it creates instability in the region and potentially lets other rogue groups take charge of the area. So I will not go through some case studies. There's not many models I can think of on top of my head. This is very last minute again. But I realized that health and human rights is a massive topic, and I just can't physically go through every single case study, but I don't know. I just have a feeling that maybe military interventions will come up. So don't trust me on this. It's just a feeling. I can't explain it to you, but I will give you some case studies on military intervention and their mixed successes. So here are the three military interventions I talked about. So Iraq War on Terror, Libya 2011, and Rwanda. So these are different in the sense that the Iraq War on Terror had a short-term success. Libya in 2011 was questionable. And Rwanda is an example of what happens when there's no military intervention. So here's some background information on the 2003 Iraq War. I won't read it out for you. You can take it, pause it, read it. Here's the next part, how it was a success. Short-term success. How it was a failure in the long term on the Iraq War. You can pause it, read it again. And then here's the Libya intervention, how it was a success, how it was a long-term failure, I guess. And a case study on Rwanda and how the lack of intervention led to so many deaths, which is crazy if you think about it. But here it's disclaimer. So everything I've written just there was from my notes, but I am in no means pushing my political views onto you guys. And I apologize if any of the case studies have offended you or the viewpoints have clashed with you. This is merely an overview of what I was taught and what the textbook I studied showed. And at the time, I did feel that the textbook didn't paint the whole picture and pushed a very pro-UK view. And it's just the way it is, but you can shape this into your essay by saying you can mention how the UK and the West intervention, especially in the Middle East, could be fueled by oil supplies and not in the best interest of protecting human rights. So that is another point you can make. You can talk about how the effectiveness of intervention, especially from the West, is perhaps not in the best interest of people and human rights, but more so to do with the resources they can gain from it. All right, so finally, I didn't do migration, so I will not have anything to do with that. So let's move on to the final bit. So motivation, guys. You guys are halfway there. After tomorrow, you'll be done, basically. So my offer to you guys, if you get an A star on A somehow, just remember, drop me a DM on my business accounts in the description, and I will somehow treat you to Nando's, if that's a motivation. Or if you don't like Nando's, I will give you the finest £5 Tesco meal deal. Yeah, I'm not sure if that's motivation for you guys, but you know, if you succeed somehow, I'll be very happy. And yeah, what to do now? It's up to you guys now for the last 5 hours of the day. Annotate the spec and run through some exam questions. And good luck, and make sure to watch some motivational educational videos beforehand, like I showed before. So yeah, good luck, and yeah, we'll see you for paper 3.